Okay. So, hello everyone. Good morning, guys. So, let me introduce myself first, right? So, my name is Shubham, Shubham Joshi. And basically, I'm from Jaipur, right? And I have a startup in Jaipur, which I'm trying to write. So, it is related to legal technology, right? So, before joining the startup or before starting this startup, right? I was a full-time lawyer, practicing lawyer, and I have 5 years of experience, like post-graduation, 5 years of experience in legal field, right? In those 5 years, I've been part of many organizations. I've been part of many state judicial functions and everything, right? So I was a litigator first, and then I got into consultancy, and started providing consultancy to startups, to even to government agencies regarding the intellectual property rights and the formation, right? So to be honest, like more on I've been part in, for the technology and legal and design, right? So design is personally very, it's something, it is very close to my heart, right? Because I've been a practicing designer. So I was more of a graphical designer in college, out of practice, right? But once I just got out of college, right? So I started practicing legal, right? But now I'm also, just trying to switch to designing field, right? Because startup requirements such that I have to switch to designing field. So I'm also part of IDF Rajasthan. Okay, so that's why how I got in touch with Romy, and we discussed things and I was starting taking session. So this session would be more of a designer take on the legal, right? So I won't be talking as a lawyer. So I'll be sharing my experiences as a designer, right? How things has to be in the legal industry and not dream. So what we are trying to solve through my startup is that how to make that particular legal procedure so simple that every other people can access, right? Currently, if anyone hears that, they have to get into legal trouble, right? So everyone takes their hands out of it and don't want to continue with the process, right? Because they do not understand each and everything what legal goes into. So with startup, we are trying to bring that kind of information to people those require legal and are not from the legal background. So I think this is a sufficient introduction, right? So if you guys allow, so let me start with the session, right?
Sure, Shubham. Yeah, thanks for sharing the brief. And it's really a great combination to know law and design at the same time. I think even I have a lot of questions already for you. And I'm sure we all will have a lot of questions regarding this because it comes in our daily life in that way.
Exactly, Romy.
Yeah.
So, Romy, so when we talk about the law and design, so where they meet, right? So, as you know that, like, India is a democratic country, right? So, but democracy doesn't mean that everyone do as they wishes, right? So, there are set of laws and procedures to keep balances, right? So, everyone can have a set principle rules which they can follow. And similarly, right, even the designing industry, they are set patterns, right? So, they are not laws which are directly impacting the designing industry, right? Because they are not procedural, they are not regulatory body which keeps in check the designing process and the designing work, right? Because regulating something doesn't mean that it will be very effective, right? And in India, a lot of sectors are heavily regulated, right? But the thing is that regulation doesn't mean it comes with a proper channel, it comes with a proper proper output which is defined by the regulated body. That's why I pretty much think that if design is not being regulated by anybody, it is a beneficial for the designing industry, right? Because regulation comes with a lot of procedure, a lot of things which has to be followed, right? So either a designer follows the procedure and keeps checks the compliances of the process of the industry, or he can work as a designer, right? They cannot be both, right? And still, if a designer has to grow, then he has to hire a particular person who can check into the regulation process and get to know, right? That's why if it is the designing field is not regulated, I'm pretty much sure that it is in the benefit of the designing industry, right? Okay, so if we talk about what are the laws impacting the designing industry, right? So there are general laws which affect the design industry. For example, let's say if you get into any work relationship with a person, right? Then there is a contractual law, right? So contractual laws plays in, right? So once you have created a particular set of designs or particular intellectual property, then the intellectual property laws are there, right? And then there are labor laws which goes into place between the employer and the employee relationship, which has to be managed, right? So they are general set of laws which are applicable to each and every industry, but not particular to the design industry. And this is how the designing industry is also governed by those laws. Okay, so just to start with, so what I have done, because I cannot cover each and everything, right? So before I start my session, right, I just want to inform you, right? So do not take it as a legal advisory from any sort of, right? So this is just an information which I'm trying to share it with. Each and every case and each and every scenario is different, right? So this is not, please do not consider as a legal advice, right? Because as a lawyer, we are not, we are not allowed to provide legal advisory like this on our channel. So if you want to take legal advice, it's your personal matter, right? So do contact me. I'll be sharing my contact information, right? But this information solely for the knowledge purpose. Is do not take it. I do not solely rely on this information and deal your cases accordingly, right? So do consult a legal person before you take action on the knowledge provided by me, right? Because your case can be different from the case which I've been mentioning, right? So having said that, so let's start with, right? So what I'll be doing is I'll be dealing with the major laws, right? Which I think that impacts design industry indirectly, right? So even like before taking this session, we Ratul, Romy and I had have a conversation like how to keep this session, right? So as I said that I'll be dealing as a designer, not as a legal person, right? So so just stop me if I get too technical about the legal things, right? Because I totally guys understand that you come from a design background, you might not be aware about the legal jargons that goes in the industry, right? So anytime, like, because you cannot take a lawyer out of a person, right, once he has become a lawyer, right? So it is very hard for me to just restrict myself to a designing person, right? Because legal terminologies can come in between, and it is very normal for me, right? So just stop me if you do not understand anything, if it is getting too legally complicated for you. So but the purpose of this session is to make it more informative and to keep it general, right? So I won't go too legally technical into this session, right? So what I'll be sharing the general information regarding a particular law. And what are the normal practices and how designers should be governing those practices and what is implemented. So for legal advice, it is something very separate, but this is just deal it as an information, right? So I'll be covering two or three points which I think is very important for a designer to know, right? So first we'll be dealing with the IPR, intellectual property rights. So what are the intellectual property rights that are necessarily for a designer to know about, so that he can govern his rights over the product or over the services which he is providing to the client or to a company or anyone, right? Then I'll be discussing about the entity type, like how you should be starting your business as a designer, right? And what are the business entities that goes into picture and how you should be governing those entities, right? And what are the beneficial entities that you should be getting it registered and try to practice during those through those entities. So, and then also I'll be discussing, like, let's say if you get into dispute, right, then how will you be governing those disputes and how will you try to make that particular dispute work in your favor or just to have an amicably settlement in that particular kind of disputes. So let's begin with the IPR thing, I guess, right? So, as Romy said, like, how I do want to take this session, right? So if you guys have any queries regarding whatever I'm discussing, right? So what I'll do is once a topic has been discussed with you guys, right? So I'll be asking for the questions, right? And I'll be just watching over the chat. So if you have any questions, just put in the chat so that I can take up as a question and I can ask you to put it briefly in the chat and then I can ask you to expand that particular question and share your experiences. And I'll be sharing my experiences regarding that particular question. I think this works well. Am I right, Romy?
Yes, I think so. I think this format would work. So Shubham, before you just start, I'll just like to ask everyone if anyone has any question at this point in time before starts the proper discussion. Yeah.
No, I don't think so. I have any question right now.
Okay. Anyone else? Or we'll start with the discussion.
No, I don't have any question right now.
Cool. Okay. Great. So meanwhile, if you have anything to share or anything to ask, just put it in the chat I'll keep a tap on the chat, and maybe Shubham, I might just interrupt you in between if anything important comes in through the chat.
Yeah, please do it. Like, so Romy, you just interrupt in between if I'm going too fast or if I'm going too technical, right?
Sure.
So, but the thing is that because these topics are very, very information heavy, and these topics, if I have to discuss a particular intellectual property, right? Let's say particular copyright, right? So it will take me a day or two to discuss each and everything in the copyright. So I cannot go very detailed, but if I'm going in very detailed, just interrupt me in between and
absolutely,
ask me the question.
Yeah, I'll do that. Yes. Thanks. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm assuming that everyone has an access to my screen, right? So you can see what is IPR.
Okay. Yes.
We can see. Yeah.
Okay, so intellectual property is a property that arises from the human intellect, right? It is a product of human creation. So, let's have a session, right? So, what is intellectual property and what are the experiences, right? So, if anyone is there who has filed an IPR or is in the process or having heard something similar to the IPR, right, and is practicing, right, can you just share your experience with the IPR? Hello, Ratul.
Yeah, so I have never filed for any IPR, but I'm waiting for somebody to share here if anyone of you have filed for any IPR, guys. Okay, I think most of them have.
Okay, I have not filed for an IPR, but there was a case 2 years back wherein I'm not sure whether I was supposed to file an IPR for that or what I was supposed to do. So maybe this is the right platform. Maybe I can put that case forward and you can tell me what I was supposed to do.
Okay.
Now that has been solved, but still. Okay, so I participated in a international competition that was related to design and branding. So a brief was launched, and in the website of those people, they announced that the winners are supposed to get ₹50,000 cash prize and a trip to London for one member of the team. So we won that competition in 2018. It was December. And after that, we waited for an year, tried to contact them. We didn't get any amount in our account. They didn't even take our bank account details. So I was constantly looking for people who can help me get the prize money or at least contact those people. And I found few people's contacts. So after knowing these things, they usually used to tell me, okay, I'll get back to you, but they never did.
Okay.
So after getting a little aggressive on the emails, finally I received the amount 2 months back.
Okay.
Yeah. So I am not sure what...
This is not an IPR problem at all, right? So this is something, right? So they formed a relationship with you during a particular competition, and they were supposed to follow the terms and conditions, and which they failed to follow, right? So it is more of a contractual obligation, which is right, which is fine. So IPR by IPR, you think intellectual property, right? And how it is different from a normal property? So anything that comes from a particular mind and can be stated on a particular paper, right, that is an intellectual property, right? So something which you can express to the world and tell that this is a normal idea, this is something which is very entirely new for the world, and you have expressed, right? So intellectual property comprises for two distinct forms, right? So one is the literary and artistic works, and the other is the industrial property, right? So when you talk about the literary and artistic works, so if you are into writing books, if you are into paintings and musical compositions, movies, right? So that is considered as a literary and artistic work, because everything goes into paper. It is more of an expression of your idea, right? So literary and artistic works. Works kind of intellectual property, they save your expression of that particular idea, not the idea per se, right? So idea can be expressed in many forms, right? So that's why the IPR for a particular literary and artistic work has been saved by the literary and artistic works, right? Industrial property, on the other hand, it is something that describes a physical matter that is the product of an idea and concept for a commercial purpose, right? So commercial purpose is a key distinguish factor between the industrial property and normal literary and artistic work, right? So a commercial purpose is being defined by someone which an idea that can be put into a commercial product and can be sold to a large amount of people at the market, right? That is what the common distinguish between the industrial property and literary work, right? So what are the types of IPR, right? So these were the two forms. So the discussion, so I discussed these two forms, right? Now they have been like briefly introduced as the types of IPR. So when we talk about the industrial design, the trademark, copyright, trade secrets, and geography induction, so they are the kind of IPR, right? So if someone has to ask you like in which particular your concept falls into, then you have to look into the details, right, and just have to segregate yourself into this particular type of idea. It can be industrial design, trademark and copyright, and trade secret geography induction. I think so, industrial design has everyone seen, and trademark has everyone had experience, right, because they have seen trademarks, right? So there are two other forms of IPR, which is trade secrets and geography induction, which not everyone is not aware about. Yes, Ratul, you were asking some questions.
Yes. So in case of any IPR, mm-hmm. when a person should approach the lawyer during the whole process.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
As soon as the idea came to the mind, mm-hmm. or before the first meeting with the client, or
exactly.
Is there any? During the first meeting, some people does non-disclosure agreement they create. So the guy need to move to the lawyer for IPR before the non-disclosure agreement need to be created, or after that, how it should be?
Okay, I think that's a great question, right? When you do need to involve a lawyer in when you're thinking about the IPR, right? So I think everyone has a question, right? Before I discuss about this question, right? So just let me tell you my experience with the IPR filing. So far I've been into industrial design filing, trademark and copyright, right? So trade secrets and geography indication, they are very rare, right? Even trade secrets are not registered. If they are registered, they are open to the industry, right? So that's why trade secret is something which hasn't been discussed even to the third person also, right? So if I talk about my experiences with the other kind of IPR, let's say industrial design, trademark, copyright. So people, once the idea occurs, people think that it is a very very special idea. They think that they should be saving it and write for it. So people are not really clear about what they should be doing with this particular idea, right? So intellectual property rights exist, but should you be exercising that right is a major question before you hire a lawyer, right? So, because let's say you have a particular idea about industrial design. Let's say you have a idea of a bottle, right? The shape of the bottle, the total look of the bottle, how it should be looked, right? Okay. So, should you be getting industrial design? That's a particular question. Like, are you willing to commercialize it, right? So, before you approach industrial design as an IPR, right? So, you should be asking some few questions, right? So, what are the kind of questions that you'll be asking yourself? The first question is that, okay, let's say I get a industrial design copyright over this particular product, right? So, how will you be able to monetize it, right? What is the proper business? What is the proper business plan which I have in mind regarding this industrial design, right? So, because getting an IPR is not a big deal, how you access that particular intellectual property is a major pertinent question that you should be asking yourself, right? So, if you have a business objective in mind, let's say you design a bottle, right? And then what you can do is you can assign that particular industrial design copyright to a particular company or a particular group, right? Who are into manufacturing drinks or something kind, which can use that particular kind of bottle, right? So, you should be asking these questions like how to move forward with my industrial design copyright so that I can exercise my rights accordingly. So I think I've made it very clear. So once you have figured out so there is a business use case for that particular industrial design, right, then you should be approaching a lawyer, and then NDA can be signed, right? But the thing is that signing NDA with a lawyer, I think every lawyer will be pretty much happy signing an NDA. They don't have any objectives around the NDA, right? But the thing is that even lawyers will be questioning your ideas first, right? If a lawyer isn't questioning your idea regarding the particular design, I think that's not a great lawyer, right? Because even lawyers need to make sure that whatever the amount of energy that he or she will be putting in that particular designing, getting designing rights, is being substantiated by the particular fees. And also there has to be a good objective, right? Because even he needs to establish a relationship with the client and get to know like what kind of a business prospect the client is thinking about this particular design. I think that makes a particular answer. So is there anything which I'm missing or you need to know more about?
No, I think for me, I am pretty clear about it now because I had the same set of questions. I did not know when exactly should I reach out to the lawyer before I am done with all the design and ideas, etc. Or what is it?
So also, so also it depends on the kind, like type of IPR you're going after. Like, let's say if you're a designer, if you're a product designer, and I know you just want to get an industrial design copyright over product right for. Okay, so getting industrial design copyright, it's a very technical process, right? And it needs to, you need to hire a particular a researcher first, like who can look into the industrial design journals and see that if there are similar products which you're trying to get industrial design, right? Because idea is just not a good proof that it is a novel, right? So you need to check a novelty of an idea, like how novel this particular design is when you compare to designs which are existing or which has been published in the journal, right? So I think this particular clears the question, right?
Yes. These different type of IPRs are there, and there are different approaches to it, and at different time the person need to visit lawyer or other consultants for getting these things done. But what I'm more inquisitive is, normally a designer, there are some of the designer who practice in big corporate, and there are team of lawyers and behalf of the corporate, whatever design they have created, whatever idea they have, they put it forward to the team of lawyers, like IP department is there in Microsoft and all. So if somebody is working for Microsoft, a designer, then once they create something, they can put forward to the IP department. Even in Harman, where I worked, IP department was there. So we can put rubbish idea also to them. They will have a look, and then they will get back to us if they feel like that idea is something to be considered. They will get back to us. But when you are practicing design all kind of other creatives all by yourself, at that time there is a very big gap which I have noticed between a designer and he getting a legal help. So also if you search online, there's lot of information. It's mostly like information overload for the designer. And everybody try to explain it, but things get very complicated very soon. 5 minutes down the lane, you won't understand what the other person is. Because a lot of terminology, a lot of things get into. So is there a website or anything where you can suggest a self-help website where a designer can visit, and in very few clicks, he can figure it out, the kind of idea he have. What is the importance of getting it first of all, create the IP for it, or registered under the IP, his idea, and how much of time it will take, what is the cost he could expect, and should he be asking the client to get it done? So these kind of basic things, self-help, in a very self-help way, not in very textual way, but in a very visual way, where you can get this through in as little time as possible.
Ratul, I think that's a great question, right? And I think everyone, like every designer here, is under dilemma, like who should be getting IPR, and it is whose responsibility. Like, let's say if you're working for a client and if you're working for a corporate or anything like that. Honestly, like when a designer is practicing particular designing, right, he is doing it for a client, right? Okay, he's not the one who will be getting the IPR, right? So let's say if you have started working, as you mentioned, that you're working for a good company, right? Those who have good IPR team with them, right? And they are looking into each and everything that they can generate an IPR, right? So there's a team in your company, like who looks after into IPR, right? But for a normal set of designer, just to get that kind of particular infrastructure is pretty much a deficient scenario, right? Because he won't be having that kind of infrastructure where he will be able to figure out by themselves, right? In terms of by practice side designer, they know more about the design aspect, right? So let's say if you pick a general, right, journal, let's say if you pick a design patent general, right, where the design industrial designs are being patented, designing are copyrighted, right? So a particular design can have a set of look into a particular journal and just look at the product, right? Okay, these are the design specification, right? But also with that particular journal comes with the legal bindation, like what are the classes that the design patent has been patented under, right? So these are very legally technical, right? Technical, which a designer might not be able to. Let's say if a designer, because even the Indian IPR regime, they provide a particular infrastructure for a designer to patent, like get a patent, to get a copyright, get an industrial designing done by himself, right? So it's not a mandatory for a specialized person to be there with you, right? So I think IPR regime provides that, right? But he should be doing it is another question, right? And in general, let's say if you are a freelancer, if you're a designer like who's working for a particular client, right? So I think you should be giving this particular burden of filing an IPR to the client, right? And not should be doing yourself, right? Because there are a lot of legal hassles, there's a lot of procedural hassle that comes in between, and this is what the things are meant to be, right? Because legal is a separate field and designing is a separate field, right? And the IPR is a merger of these fields. It's not specifically a particular restrictive design or particular restrictive legal field, right? Even if you see that in India, right, so they are not very good IPR lawyers, right? Because you will find traditional colleges, those who provide IPR as a subject, right? But people do not know how to design a particular application regarding a particular site, right? So it requires two set of knowledge. One is the legal and one is the industry knowledge about the particular IPR. So let's say if you are into industrial design, right? So then you should be having a person who understands design, the basic concept, how the industrial designs are being made, right? What are the process, right? How to broaden the scope of that particular application, right? Even an application can be filed in so many ways regarding a particular idea, right? So you should be choosing a lawyer who has a good set of knowledge, not only about the legal aspect, also but the designing the industry aspect, right? So as you said, that your company, right? So I'm pretty sure if your IP team is there, right, then IP team should be having it should be multidisciplinary. It won't be a legal team only. There will be designer who has some knowledge of legal, and there will be people who come from legal background and has some knowledge about the designing industry. That's how the IPR teams are being formed, right? If not working properly, and I'm not sure if designing does these kind of things by himself, he will be able to get a good intellectual property right. Right? He may get an intellectual property right, but he may not be able to exercise judicially in terms of just making the most out of that particular intellectual property right. So the application has to be set in such a way that in future any problem arises regarding that particular intellectual property, it has to be exercised in the court of law. And the court of law, they don't just see that it has been filed by the designer or it has been filed by the lawyer. Right? So whatever goes in the application, the court sees that particular application and decides the case accordingly. Right? So anyone who is a designer and who's looking to get an IPR, right? So I'll just advise you, okay, you can look into the designing aspect, you can look into the features, what goes into designing, right? Okay, but do get a technical help. It may not be that you hire a good IPR attorney, right? IPR attorney, but you should be having some knowledge of legal aspect of the patent, so that you can get the rights in your favor.
So, in this case, is there IP consultants who are not lawyers or who are not from law background, but they have been practicing particularly this kind of regulatory consultations? And they would pitch in, you know, when you get to them with a design, and they will do the preliminary task and set the whole thing, set the stage, yes, and then forward it to the lawyer and the attorney.
So yeah, so in general, so there are two kind of lawyers, right? So one field is particular litigation, right? The people who goes to court, right, who argues the case and everything. So they are they are a different set of people and they are different set of legal practitioner, right? So they have a license to practice in the court, and so whatever a dispute arises, they are the people who fight the cases, right? Okay, and then there are advisors, like corporate advisors, they are IPR advisors, right? Those who are industry specific, they don't go to court, right? But they are very good at documentation, right? And intellectual property, right, kind of subjects, they require good documentation about the particular set of idea or about a particular set of product, right? So you should be consulting a particular, specific someone who is very good at recognizing the intellectual property, okay, and who is very good in filing an application, right, on behalf of you, right? Because once he knows that what is the product, he may be knowing that what is the right procedure to get this particular intellectual property, right? And still, if you do it by yourself, I think it will take you ages to get an intellectual property, right? Because they're so, like, it is very procedural heavy. Which you know, and if you are able to, like, let's say if you have get a brief understanding about the procedure, you might not be able to navigate yourself to the procedure, right? Because then there are people like who object to intellectual property once you're published in general. So these kind of things goes on, but how to revert back with a particular answer, right? Even that shouldn't be a job of a designer. It should be a job of a legal practitioner, because those replies are taken by the court, right, and judge accordingly, right? So it may happen as a designer, you may file a reply on the objection that has been presented by the other people once your IPR has been filed, right? So if your reply is not very strong, right, I'm pretty sure that the patent office officer or whoever is the person, right, who is dealing with your intellectual property might not be taking interest, right? Because as a job of the intellectual property an intellectual property officer, your job is to assess the application, right, not the intent behind it. So designer thinks that they have a very good intent, they have a very everything right for it, but it's not about the intention, it is what goes on the paper, right, which has been which goes into the intellectual property officer's mind, and then they take a decision accordingly. So it's right. Very important to get an application right in a right particular manner.
Okay, it happens that a lot of people diversify from their field based on their likings and when they see that they are being good at something. So the one good example is UX writing, which is getting very popular these days. Mm-hmm. And earlier writing being considered someone who have done masters in English or master in some language, and they are been in the field of content writing, and it was considered that it is their domain, they need to take it up. But now what happened that the field, the user experience has diversified, and user experience guys have seen that writing have a very important factor on the websites, on the applications, in micro interactions, and in the design. So a field have been diversified called UX writing. So that has soon becoming a very established field, and a lot of UX guys who have been doing all these years, they have been doing some kind of technical documentation, or they've been sitting with the content writer. They are now getting into this field as UX writers. I would like to know, because as you say that there are, these IP laws, and the lawyers in India are not very evolved. There are not many good lawyers available who understand IP laws and the changing dynamics of the creative industry, fast and rapid changing dynamics. So from that perspective, if our fellow UX guys, they want to diversify into writing applications, writing procedural IP laws related applications and all those things, so can they get into that? And the idea is to, once they get into that, they will do the preliminary work, set the thing ready, because they have been in the industry for probably 5 years, 10 years, something like that. They have learned a certain part of IP and all those things. They themselves might have faced a lot of challenges. They might have seen a lot of gaps. And now they are trying to, bridge that gap for the rest of the designers. So they would do the preliminary work, sit with the rest of the designer, make sure that whatever the expectations are need to be met from both the parties. And then as an intermediary, they will forward those things to the attorney or the lawyer. So is it possible? Do you see anything like that happening or in the future?
Yes. So Ratul, as I like as I explained earlier, right? So I as I told you that IPR Indian IPR regime, they allow even non-expert, non-legal, like non-legal person to file an application, right? Okay. So this brings this opens a lot of job opportunities, a lot of prospect in terms of career, right? So as I told you, right? IPR is a field where two major fields, like a particular set of field, let's say, is a designing copywriter or some these kind of fields, they are merged with the legal field, right? So it's a combination of two fields. So let's say if you're very good at if you're very good at designing and just, you know, writing a design proposal or on everything, so you have a very deep expertise in a particular set of designing area, right? So definitely it's a very good scope that you can, you know, get a particular just to start, don't start practicing the filing applications and how to file an application. I'll suggest you, there are a lot of diploma courses which are done by reputed courses, which are specifically designed for in the industry's experts, right? Not for the legal practitioner, right? So I think you should be taking those diploma courses first. Okay, it will give you a whole scope of like how the legal industry works and how they are being governed, how are the processes, right? So it will give you in-depth idea about the intellectual property laws, right? So so if you are looking to shift yourself from a designer to an IPR practitioner, right? So there's a good course which is being provided by NLSIU Bangalore, right? So NLSIU is a top university, like top legal university. Even I come from Gujarat National Law University, even which is a top law university in India, right? So these institutes provide diploma courses for the industry experts, right? So you should be taking those diploma courses first, and then try to switch into practitioner IPR consultant as a practitioner IPR consultant. I think that's the question, right?
That's a very good information. I think everybody get to know about this thing, that these kind of diploma courses can help a lot of designer to diversify their portfolio, move into another thing very smoothly, and then also evolve the ecosystem accordingly.
If you want to be an IPR, right? As a person like who's practicing design, right? So if you have a good setup or a good business, those provide consultants in design in designing field, right? So I and you're a founder of that particular organization, right? I think it is very pertinent for you to get these kind of diploma courses done from a good reputed institute, right? Because once you have a good procedural knowledge about the legal, right? So your client retention will automatically goes up, right? Because your client will not only be relying for the design process, but they will also be taking the consultancy, consulting, but the procedural consultancy about the filing the IPR, and you'll be finding yourself as a very good person, right? Who can provide a good consultancy, because commercializing an IPR is a pretty huge deal, right? They are designers, but designers doesn't know how the IPR and how you can have an edge over the other industry competitors, right? Because IPR is about the competition, right? And getting you ahead in the competition, right? So if you get these kind of courses done as a business person or as a designer or as an established designer, I think it will be very helpful for your career, and it will be very helpful for your client, because he knows that a person is there, and he doesn't have to spend a lot of fees on the legal person as well, right? And you are the person who knows the designing also, and you know the legal industry also, right? So like even I have two clients from Mumbai, right? Those who are looking to get into get an IPR filed, right? So even my designing knowledge is pretty much working very fine with them, because they are coming with a lot of set of questions which is related to very specific design industry, right? And I have very information huge information about that particular designing industry, right? And I'll be like So the consultancy I've been providing to them is pretty targeted toward that particular practices, and I'm able to understand their worth, what they are trying to say, their expression, right? Because if you're a designer, if you go to a particular lawyer, right, a normal lawyer, not an IPR lawyer, I think the communication gap will exist, right? Because he doesn't understand anything about
it. Always exists,
right?
Yes.
It will always exist, right? So so knowing,
and that's a very frustrating part, because when a designer goes and meet a lawyer, he mm-hmm. don't know a lot of things, and the onboarding process, you know, at that point of time, if initial 5 minutes or 10 minutes, mm-hmm. The designer is not convinced, then mm-hmm. he would be like, probably I'm beating drums and nobody is there to, you know,
exactly. So because if I'm taking this session, right, so I'm discussing things in simplified manner. I'm not using a lot of sections. I'm not using a lot of legal terminologies, right? Sorry, because I know the target audience is a designer, right? So, but the lawyers doesn't understand this. They think that using a lot of jargon, so lot of legal technical terms, right? They will
They have to use it because it's a kind of advisory. So it will be taken as a legal consultation. So they want to be very specific on those terms that, you know, their word should not be taken as.
Exactly. So my rule of thumb is that, let's say if a client comes to me and he wants to discuss a particular idea, right? So I don't have a legal technical discussion with them, right? So whatever the legal technical discussion has to be done, I do it with my junior lawyers, right? Or I do with junior advisors, right? Because they are the one who understand it, right? But I communicate with them in a normal tone. I don't project myself as a big hotshot lawyer or big IPR hotshot lawyer, right? Because these kind of practices, they don't build trust with the person, right? And I just want to be on the same page with the client, right? To identify what are their needs, right? So all the legal terminologies, they goes into documentation, not in the communication, because documentation, legal terminologies are said for the documentation, not for the communication purpose, because communications are not being recorded and they are not provided for the court, right? So terminologies, they should be saved for the application of that particular IPR or of that particular procedural, right? Because it is important there, right? You should not be discussing it with your clients about the legal terminology, right? So having said that, so just let me move with the other points, right? So there are types of IPR, as I discussed, right? So they are copyright, patent, trademark, trade secrets, right? So what is protected under copyright? It is the original work of authorship, right? As I communicated earlier, right? The copyright is something, the expression of an idea is protected, not the idea itself, right? So if you're writing, if you're writing a particular book, or if you're generating a particular music tones and everything, right? So they are the expression of an idea, not the idea itself. That is what the copyright protects. In terms of patent, right? So in the utility and the technical feature of the patent that is being discussed, that is being protected by the particular IPR. And in terms of trademark, the business identity, the reputation of that particular business is being protected by the trademark. In trade secret, it's a business secret, right? I'm sure what is trade secret? Trade secret is something which isn't shared by the general party, which isn't shared by the third world person, or which isn't shared publicly, right? So if you know the original formula of Coca-Cola, right? So it is still a particular trade secret. No one knows what is the original formula for Coca-Cola, and no
same
one
for McDonald's also.
Even McDonald's also. So they are the people, right, who are good at protecting their business secrets. So that's why you call it trade secret, right? So why is trade secret? So trade secret is not provided. It is being practiced, right? So it is in practice in papers. Like, it has been restricted a limited amount of people, right? So the documentation is done for the people, like who knows these kind of trade secrets. So in case a person dies in a particular office and he doesn't know, he's the person who knows the trade secret, then the other person who knows the trade secret is informed, right? So it is not restricted to a person, right? It is restricted to generally a limited close group, right? And the limited close group has to go into documentation, like who knows this particular trade secret, right? So that is how the trade secrets are practices. And then the other designs are, as I told you, industrial designs, which has been practiced in India also. So there's a huge IPR regime related to industrial design, right? And it is the way it is practiced, right? But there are very few lawyers who knows industrial designs pretty decently and can get your process done very fairly and effectively.
So I will take your some time, Shubham. So Yeah, so the thing is that I want to know random stories, if you can share with our audience, about the different type of, difference in IPR over here in India and in abroad. Like there are funny stories, I'm sure you must have come across. You know, things is easy to do over there and it's very complicated over here, or things are easy over here and very complicated over there. So like that, if you would like to share anything.
Any story which I can think of is that so the story is related to related not for the patent or not for the copyright, right? The story is related to the geographic indication, this particular thing, right? Okay, so what is geographic indication? So geographic indication is that it is being provided to a particular geographical area, right? So have you heard about Tirupati Laddu? Okay.
Yes.
So a lot of, even for example, like outside the Tirupati temple, so there were a lot of vendors like who were selling those laddus in name of Tirupati Laddus, right? Okay. So the Tirumala, the head organization who runs the Tirupati temple, right? So what they did, they got a geographic indication, right? So geography is something related to a particular area, right? So sell that particular trade, like a particular good which is being sold by a person which is known for, right? So Tirupati Laddu is something which you are very excited about, which thinks that so people started getting Tirupati Laddu outside the Tirupati temple, right? So they get curated and they got a geographic indication, right? So now you won't find any vendors who are selling Tirupati Laddu outside the temple, right? Not specifically mentioning the name that this is a Tirupati Laddu, right?
Right.
So this is how
the same thing happened between West Bengal and Orissa also. Taking this Rasgulla,
exactly, right? So West Bengal were pretty furious about that. The West Bengal is known for the Rasgullas, right? So how can you take Rasgullas out of us, right? but Orissa, I think the legal team of Orissa was pretty on the point and pretty much right. They said that the Rasgulla were like the, from the ancient time, Rasgulla were introduced in Orissa first and then the Bengal first.
Correct.
And then they got a pretty fair victory in a particular IPR cases, right? And also one funny story is, right, is that America, right? So a particular laboratory, they tried turmeric patent, okay? They get patent on a turmeric, haldi, which is, right, okay,
right,
so for the medicinal properties, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. So what happened when they try to file a patent, they try to introduce particular getting a patent in America doesn't mean that you get a patent over international forum, right? So you have to file different patent application in each country where you want to protect your idea, right? So they tried to get a patent in America and India as well, right? So Indians say that this is a general idea, right? This is nothing patentable properties in this, right? Because every Indian mother knows that the turmeric is a go-to solution when her child is in a bad state, right? So these kind of, that's why we were able to get a pretty fair picture that these kind of properties should be in terms of who's practicing, right? Not granted that it is a traditional knowledge, right? So as there is something, if it is a traditional knowledge, as in case of turmeric, right? So the patent was not allowed to use, right? Because everyone is practicing. It is very generic in nature, and everyone knows it. Right. Also funny story about trademark is, there is one funny story about a trademark, right? So if you know Thumbs Up, right?
Yes, Thumbs Up.
Thumbs
yes.
Up. It's even pretty good trademark. Like everyone recognizes, yes. Thumbs Up. What is Thumbs Up? And right. Okay. So actually, when they entered, when the product was out, right? Okay. So the owner of the Thumbs Up, right? So he said during that time, like Thumbs Up was not a very good it was not taken very seriously in India, right? Because people consider thanga dikha raha hai, matlab ki this should not be right, and it was very generic, right? So they said it is very generic and it doesn't suit, like it is found very indecent to show these kind of trademarks, right? Okay, so what the lawyers did, they took B out of Thumbs Up, right? So it is THUMS up, not PHUMBS, right? Now it is not generic, and then they can then they can practice.
I did not know. Okay.
Yeah. Then they can file a trademark. Then they can file a trademark, right? So these are the funny stories, right?
Yeah, a month back or a year back, I came across this video where they were creating this leaf plate, you know, which been provided to people during marriages and all. So some foreign country, somebody, you know, created the same thing, and then they started saying that this is we invented it and all those things, and then from India, a lot of people on social network created a lot of noise that this has been used in India for ages, and you cannot just simply take a idea from India and then put your stamp and rename it. So then a lot of things happened, and people get to know internationally that this.
Even I'm aware about, as an IPL lawyer, even I'm aware about that particular video, right? Because people started asking questions regarding that particular, right? Okay.
Sorry to interrupt, Shubham. I think we got one more question from Vishwajit in the chat. What is the life for any idea or design after it is created? Vishwajit, anything you want to add on to that?
I just want to share one more. Some net issue is here, so it's audible. I'm audible.
Yes, we can hear you.
So I share one like case. I mean, what I expect from my last company, what I experienced that. So one kind of design is actually created. Okay, so that is not from our side. So one of our designer use one of the background for a product. Okay, for the product. It's a 10 or 12 years back. So what happened that that designer took from somewhere and using that that product background. So that time nobody noticed, and that product is launched somewhere. So that designer also left the company, and that time the manager also not available. But after 9 or 10 years, so somebody those who are have actually created that thing, they came to and they filed that that this is their property.
Yeah.
So they don't use to that. So that's why I'm asking. So any idea is design is created, or its idea is developed, any lifetime for that, or it is a universal life? Anybody can file an IPR against that anytime. It's not matter 10 years, 20 years, or it's a lifetime.
I think some of the things I have heard, there is 5 years of lifetime, and a lot of time it happens that there are products being created and then IP been taken. And
no,
5 years
actually,
nobody
used. Rathul, my question is, we are deal with that digital platform. So basically that... Hello. Yeah. So actually, we're dealing with the digital platform nowadays. So many digital idea and these things. If you find the dribble and all these things for inspiration kind of thing. So many things is available over there. So my question is that any life or anything for this thing is available for.
Yeah, so Vishwajit, the thing is that it depends on what kind of intellectual property you possess, right? Okay. So let's say, as I told you, if you have a patent, right? So the term of protection is 20 years, right? So if you get a patent for 20 years, right, the term will be 20 years for that particular idea, right? So on document it is 20 years. Otherwise, the life of the patent when the other same kind of similar kind of patent exists, right? So it is existed there. So for 20 years, you can access that particular right. You can just assign it to someone else, or you can license it, or you can just build a product out of it and sell it, right? So this is how exists. But as you said that this is some background was pasted on a particular product, right? So I think this comes into the copyright area. Okay. So copyright is protected for 60 years, right? Subject to if it is being used in that particular manner only, right? If there no changes has been made, no major changes has been made to that particular copyright, then I think that copyright is protected for 60 years.
Okay. Okay.
So that's, I think that's the question, right? And then there are different the term of protection that is being provided. Like as I told you, for patent is 20 years, right? For example, for trademark, the valid is for 10 years, right? Can be renewed, subject to renewal, right? So that's how you can you can just get a particular set of IPR, and then there is a specific time limit, right? I think which is more than enough, right? Because now the industry and things are moving so fast, right? Even 10 years it sounds like pretty much a pretty big deal, right? Even people who are getting a particular IPR don't practice that particular the particular product for 10 years, right? Everything goes into extinction, right? New products are introduced, new materials are introduced, new ideas are introduced, right?
So yes. Nowadays, this is moving so fast. Like one idea is this, like within 2 or 3 years, it's a backdated kind of thing. Like now, industry is moving so fast for any ideas or any.
Exactly. So now people are more into get into market first, right? So correct. Then there are different strategies that is being dealt by, right? So even let's say if you die, if you have generated a copyright, let's say you have a copyright of a particular work, right? Even if you die, that exists on after 50 years after your death, right? Once you have died, right? So copyright exists, right? So there's a term that goes into copyright, but the thing is that practicing copyright is very difficult, right? So if you want to change if you want to use a copyrighted material, right, then you can make substantial amount of work changes to that particular copyright, and then you can have that particular copyright in your favor also. So changes can be made, but you cannot use same material which you have copyrighted over someone else, right? So you have to make substantial changes to remove the copyright of that particular person which your idea you're using, right?
So one more question, Shubham, it's like as a designer, if I develop or design idea or something, so what is my immediate responsible person to deal with, let's say my manager, and some big company or some branded company, they have a different set of IPR team. After my developed immediate to whom I am responsible to show them the idea, and it should not the copyright for in future. So you understood, right?
So let me tell you how to know that your particular idea is worthy of IPR, right? Getting intellectual property right over your idea, right? So let's say copyright. Let's say you are a particular you have come up with an idea. First of all, the idea has to be novel, right? It should be new. It shouldn't be reproduced from someone else's work, right? Or it should have some kind of element, right, which gives a novel idea, right? It shouldn't have been in public, in public, right? So that everyone can see, this is not an idea which is a new, right? So it should be novel, first of all, right? Just to check the novelty, let's say if you are a designer, right, and you can do graphic designing, right, so what you can do inverse image search on Google, right, and just check that are there any similar kind of designs available over the market, right? So once you have figured out, so that's a normal Google search, right? Let's say if you don't find anything, right, anything over that particular, and you think, no, it is something novel, right, then you should move to an IPR engine, right? So there are IPR search engines specifically, right? Even if you just type in Google, right, Google patents, right, then there is a search engine for patents that is being provided by Google, right, where you can just search specifically patents and similar for copyright. And in terms of copyright, so copyright doesn't has to be it is not mandatory to get it registered, right? So the moment the work is produced, the copyright started existing on that particular work, right? Now it is up to, so why do people get registration of a copyright? It's just to get an authority over an idea, right? Because let's say you produce a work, right, and if you haven't registered, right, and similar thing happens between and you move to a court, right? So court will be taking you seriously if you have copyright registered, right? Otherwise it will not be considered as a copyright, because the same kind of problem are being faced by the film industry, right? So the writers from the film industry, they have produced a lot of scripts, right, for it, and they haven't got the copyrighted, right? So once a similar kind of script is produced, right, and that particular script is registered under the copyright, then court will be taking that particular registered copyright seriously, not your idea. Still, there are instances where court has seen that when the first, like, what was the first instance the idea came into picture and by which person, right? So even these kind of things, right? But just getting it registered means that you're formally acknowledging that this is a particular normal idea which I'm aware of and no one has done it before. So I think everyone will be taking you serious. That's why you should be getting registration over your very novel idea which you think which might be impacting you, right? So just conduct the searches online. First of all, in terms of copyright, in terms of patent, just do a Google search and then do the IPR research over the online, right? And for trademark, right? So let me just introduce the how to search a trademark. Let's say you are starting a particular company or you're starting a proprietorship, right? And now you just want to search, like, is that particular name available or is a particular trademark which I've designed is available for the market, right? And I think every designer, like who's a graphical designer or who designs illustrations or these kind of things for the client, right? So this picture comes to mind, should I be getting a trademark over this particular designs or not, right? And if I have to get a trademark, right, should I be moving to a lawyer or I can conduct a search by myself, right? So before you moving a lawyer, what you can do is, let me just take you to an official website for India. So this is ipindia.nic.in. Okay, so this is a particular, just look at my laptop screen, right? I think I'll share the laptop screen with you guys. Okay, so this is an official ipindia.nic.in website that is being provided by India, right? Just to make you more informed about the process of the intellectual property rights, right? And it is very friendly for the user, right? Because even they have been trying to propagate the IPR, right? And the Indian industry has not adopted intellectual property rights as the other industry has taken into effect, right? So that's why they have come up with a very simple, easy to use website, right? So if you go to ipindia.nic.in, you will find these kind of all the information regarding particular IPRs, right? For patents, you can just move on the patent and you can just get. So there are FAQs available which they have answered in terms of very normal layman kind of understanding, right? So that everyone can understand. So if you have any queries, you can always go to FAQs and just get it sorted, right? Before you move to hiring a law stage, or you think that your idea is novel, it should be patented, and if it has some business value attached to that particular idea, right? Then you can go for design also, trademark also, GI also, these kind of things, right? And for trademark, if you have designed a logo, if you need to search, right? If you need to search that particular trademark exists or not, then what you can do is you can go to particular search engine, trademark search engine, right? You can just type trademark search engine. Search India, right? Okay, so the first link which shows a public search, right? So every public can search particular trademark and everyone can get, right? You don't need to hire a lawyer, they do a trademark search, right? Even you can search it, right? But things get very technical, right? But also there is a solution for that technical things, right? So just go to a public search link, right? And you'll find this particular window. Is everyone able to see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, so this is ipindiaonline.gov.in trademark search, right? So you'll find this particular search engine which is being provided by the government, right? So that everyone can look into the designs and just see that the same idea, similar idea, similar logo or similar trademark exists, right? Okay, so
ma'am, just a request, maybe can you share the link with us in the chat also, please?
Chat also, okay,
in chat, yeah. So that we can just open it along with and just refer to it if required. Yeah.
Okay. So just let me copy the link.
Yeah. And go to Zoom and go to the Zoom conference.
This is chat, right? For everyone.
Where is it? I cannot. Yes. Right.
Yeah. I've got it.
Correct.
Okay. So you got right.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've shared the link with you guys. Okay, so if you open the link, right, then you'll get this window. Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. Well. Okay. So there are three kind of searches, right? Search related to word mark, right? So everything like even Vienna Code mentioned the trademark also, and then phonetic searches, right? So phonetic searches are something like which are which sounds very similar, the trademark which sounds very similar. If you let's say for example. So Adidas, like Adidas, right? Adidas is a particular trademark which is available, right? Okay. So let's say if you come up with Adibas, not D but B, right? Okay. So it will be restricted under phonetic, right? Because it is very similar sounding in nature. Okay. Do you get my point?
Yeah, that's kind of like local market T-shirt or something. Yeah, they are using little bit similar, but not related to that actually.
It has to be very deceptively sounds very similar, right? It
correct.
Should it, like you're not able to like Alpen Liebe. There are so many products related to Alpen Liebe, right? So they have Mother right. Dairy. So these kind of things, right? So
they use a Nike, NIDE, not
exactly.
A, correct.
Exactly. So these are the trademarks, right? So they are very phonetically similar, right? So they cannot if you do a trademark search, right, and they sound very deceptively very similar, I think trademark can be restricted if you have designed this particular kind of trademark, right? So just to search phonetically, you can just go on phonetic and just mention, and then you can type three similar characters, right? So there is a very famous case related to this kind of practices, right? If you have heard about if you had heard about Burger King,
I heard. I saw in Hyderabad. Yeah, Burger King.
Yeah, so Burger King is the original trademark, right? Okay, and one Indian entrepreneur, he has filed a trademark for Burger Singh.
Yes. Singh, okay, I don't know.
Really? Yeah,
and Burger Singh is a very established startup, right? So they have outlets in so many places. It is very established, right? Okay, now Burger King has filed a case against Burger Singh that they cannot get a trademark, and the case is still going on. Okay, it is in particular legal dispute, right? So that's how, right? But make sure you don't get into these kind of a phonetically similar kind of trademark, right?
So, I think one more example which Paul mentioned in the chat is quality and quality. It sounds the same, but only the spelling is different.
Spelling is
exactly. So this is quality, okay. Even quality is a good trademark, right? Because the thing is that quality is a generic word, right? As I gave you an example of thumbs up has been done into thumbs up, right? So same the quality Q has been replaced by K, right? So it doesn't it is not general anymore, right? And industry can use it, right? So a spelling can be done, right? Because quality is not a trademark. Quality is a generic word. And you cannot get a quality trademark over our product, right? But you can get quality with K as a trademark, and which people have done it before. So I think that's not a question to argue. But you can do these kind of creative things with your trademark and get it registered if similar things doesn't exist, right? Okay, so the most general trademark is the word trademark, right? Word trademark, as in you take a word and you try to get it trademark on this particular, right? So my startup Lawnix, right? So it has law and nix, right? So it's a combination of two words, right? So that's why I've used a trademark. That's similarly the same trademark can be developed by you and can be searched too. For example, let's say if I have to make a search, right? Okay, I've already searched, right? So this is IKEA, right? IKEA. Okay, so I think everyone is every designer is aware about what IKEA is, right? So if you're a product designer, yes. You must be aware about IKEA, right? Okay, yes. So you have entered, like, let's say if you want, if you have come up with this word mark that I should be using IKEA for my products, right? Then as a person, you're searching, is it available or not, right? So you enter IKEA, okay? So there are these three options, right? Start with, contains, or match with, right? Okay. even these, you have to search all of these three, right? What are the possible options, right? Then you can, first of all, you can start with, okay? And then you can write the trademark name, and then you have to enter a class, right? But you do, as a normal designer, no one knows what the class is, right? In which class this particular word mark should be representing, right? So what happens? So let's say if you come with an intellectual property, let's say you come with the industrial design, you come with a trademark, right? So so people ask, okay, so you want to get it registered, but what class it does belong to, right? So it can be a food product, it can be beverages, it can be a different product, it can be material product, it can be a service, can be a product, right? So so what they have done it, there was one convention that that took place on a world level, or on a world level. So what happened is that even India was a party. So what every country has taken, so they will be following a particular class system, right? Which will be general to every country, right? So that it makes easier for people to get patent and trademark in that particular class around every world, right? So there's a proper class system followed by each and every country, right? So in this particular search engine, so they are asking about the class, like on what, like in which class does your particular trademark belongs to, right? And even like for lawyers who are practicing, even I do not remember each and every class, right? So even I have to search out for the particular class, right? So what you can do is just to search what class it does belong to. You can.
Okay. Okay. Maybe we can take this up at a later stage, digging down into things, because it's a never ending.
It's a never ending, right? So you can go to like eupo.europa.eu. So they have classes, right? So you just write down on what class do you want to get registered, right? So let's say I said furniture, right? So once I search for the furniture, right? So the presenting class will. Okay.
I think we should take some time away from this thing, because we have discussed a lot about IP and trademarks and all these things right now. And we should be talking a little about the kind of, you know, business is all about related to design. So I have put up a question in the chat for everyone.
He already has a nice presentation for us already. So maybe we can go through that. Just to keep in mind, we have only half an hour more to go. Then we'll have to end the call.
Yeah. Exactly. So So let's move on the business aspect, right? Like, how should you be practicing as a designer, right?
Yes.
So I think that would be pretty good, right? So IPR, as I told you, that each and every topic is very close to my heart, and I can take a session for entire 2 days related to one topic, right? So it is so in-depth and it is so knowledgeable, right? So I cannot share each and everything, right? But I think I have given you a general idea about the intellectual property, right, that exists in the designing industry, right? So so let me move with the process. And for the good references, I've already made slides, and you can just what are the processes, what is the registration processes for a particular IPR. So I mentioned it, right?
This would be very helpful. Yes.
That particular, right? So these are the familiar trademarks, which is, and then copyright, right?
Right.
So let me just go down to industrial design is there, and then these are the right. Okay. So how should you be conducting business, and how should you be extending yourself as a business entity, right? So first of all, let me brief you about what business entities are, what legal entities are, right? Okay, so legal entities are a body double of a particular person or a particular idea, right? So for example, if you need to conduct a business, right? So there are so many ways to conduct a business, right? Either you do it personally, right? So if you're doing it personally by your own name, right, then it is proprietorship. Proprietors are the person, right, who doesn't have any registered entity in place, right, or they are registered as a proprietor, then they are showing up for a business in personal capacity by their name and right. So in this kind of particular legal entity, the personal self is not very distinguished from the business self, right? So they, the both the personality are very same, right? And they can be governed by each and every one them, right? So anything happens, that the liability is strictly aiming for the personal being, right? It is not a separate entity, right? So there are so many entities, right? But what the famous entities are, they are private limited company, limited liability partnership as a sole proprietor, and the partnership firm, right? Okay, so as I told you, the sole proprietor, you don't need to register yourself as a sole proprietor. If you're conducting a business by your name only and you haven't registered anywhere, then automatically you fall under to sole proprietorship. Okay, and then they are partnership firms, right? So what happens in partnership firms? So the liability of conducting business, the profit loss and the liabilities to comply, right? They fall equally on all the partners. That's how the partnership firms are built, right? So if you get into partnership firm with a buddy of yours, right? So that means that you, both of you, share the equal responsibility, equal liability, and equal profit and loss in that particular entity. Then a modified version of partnership is LLP, which is limited liability partnership. In limited liability partnership, you can assign the extent of liability that goes into business, right? The personal liability that goes into business, right? Then you can then you can form an LLP and it works according to the agreement you have made among yourself, right? And then they are private limited companies, right? As my startup, it is registered as a private limited company, right? So private limited companies are formed for a business idea which is going to get pretty big, right? And you might be able to get resources, help, and everything right for it. So private companies should be registered only when you think that the business will be very big and you won't be able to handle, right? And the kind of number of members that will be involved in private limited company can be pretty huge, right? And the chances of going public also increases if you try to get private limited. So let's say if you're a designer and if you're looking to get your funding from a particular investor, right, then you should be registering yourself as a private limited company, not LLP, not sole proprietorship, not partnership. Because in private limited company, you get so many exercising rights and you can just navigate those rights according to your needs, right, which is not possible in LLP, sole proprietorship and partnership. Okay, so registration is possible of like every entity has to be registered. The reason you get registered these entities is because of the kind of business you deal with, right? So let's say if you present in a personal category or as a sole proprietorship, it means that so any losses or any profits or any cases which is being done by the other party, it will be in your sole capacity and your personal finances will be affected, right? So when you register a private limited company, LLP or a partnership firm, it means that the bank account of that particular company will be affected, not the personal bank account of company, or the financial liability will be of the legal entity, not the personal capacity, right? So if your business goes big, or you think that you're generating a very good cash flow out of that particular businesses, right, that you should be thinking about one of those entity, not the sole proprietorship. So how you should be like, what are the general practices that are being taken care of when you just want to register yourself? So it is that let's say if you're a student now, and as a student you want to practice designing, want to brush up your skills, then as a sole proprietor you can just brush up your skills and you can just, you know, get into business engagement or get into internship and everything, right? So you'll be representing as representing yourself as a sole proprietorship. If you start practicing and once you're established, let's say a year or two, three down the lane, once you have graduated from the college, right, and the practices are pretty good, right, for it, then I think you should think about getting into LLP with a person, right, with those who can help you out around, and you can get in. You should be conducting your business through LLP, right? And if you think that, yeah, no, it will be one day, it will be very big, and it will be like every designer hopes so. It will be very big one day, then you should be registering yourself as a private limited company, right? Because it will give you more flexibility in terms of practicing your business rights over the others, right? So I think private entities are clear to everyone, right?
Yeah, I would also, there's this new thing called one person company. I think 2 years or 3 years back only it has been established. Mm-hmm. So a little more about one person company and how it is different from sole proprietorship.
So no, so sole proprietorship is very different. A company is very different, right? As I told you, right? So you may ask like how it is very different from a private limited company, which is a normal company structure, right? Okay, so to start a private limited company, right? So there has to be at least two directors, okay? So to starting a private limited company, right? And for the one person company, as the name suggests, right, only one person is required, right? And so every process is same, similar. In terms of one person company and private limited company, it's just that it is being started by one person company, right? But ultimately what happens is because as company gets pretty big, right? Okay, so as soon as the other person joins, right, so it gets turned into a normal private limited company, and one person company tag is taken from those particular company, right? So there are conversion procedures that has to be taken care and plus also one person in one person company the practicing or the compliances are not that strict as compared to the private limited company, because compliances for the private limited company, they are pretty huge compared to other kind of legal entities. So registering yourself as a private limited company, you should be checking that do you have a budget to stick around as a private company, then only it is feasible for you to register as a private limited company.
Yeah, that's a very valuable information, actually.
Yeah, so as I told you, like conversion dissolution, so you can read the slides, right? Because time is not with us, right? So I guess I'll be pretty much, try to run through my slides. Okay, so this is how you should be conducting businesses, right? Okay, and of time purpose, I think I can discuss each and everything in detail, right? But also as promised by us, right? So I told you I'll be sharing a basic agreement template with you guys, right?
Right, yes.
Yeah, so is everyone am I audible, and is my screen being shared by?
We can hear your screen also, yeah.
Okay. So this is one of the most excited, I think it will be one of the exciting part of session, right? Because I think no one knows like how to negotiate an agreement and what the agreement should look like, right? So if one of your clients comes with an agreement, and the moment you see the agreement, and you see that you just go through your brain and you say like, am I in trouble, right, for doing this, for signing this, right? Because you have no idea what agreement consists, right? And you have no, go through person, right, who can just go through the agreement and just get details out of it and just tell you like, okay, you should be doing that, right? So what I'll be doing is I'll be sharing this agreement with you. Okay, so just wait a second, let me share this agreement with you. So this is a basic design or service agreement. Hello.
Hello. Yes, Shubham.
Yeah. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, it is visible.
Because I'm trying to send a file, right? I think it's open. That's why I'm not able to share it, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, now I'm able to share it.
Yeah, okay. We got
so
it. Yes.
You got it? Okay, yeah. Great. Okay, so this is a basic freelance designing template, right? Which I have drafted for a for a company, right? On behalf of company, not for the designer, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. So even in practice, let's say if you work for a client, right? So in general practice, it is a duty of the client to get into the agreement with a designer and to protect their right. So and in most of the time I have not been hired by the designer, but I have been hired by the company, right, to draft this kind of a particular template. So let me just go through the agreement. So how to use the agreement, right? Okay, so first part is the general information about the particulars of the agreement, like what will be the date, okay, and what are the information, like who are the party, right? So you have to fill it out, right? So for your convenience, what I've done it, I've just added a comment in this draft, right? So that you can just fill out this information and, you know, just get started with the agreement part.
Yes, okay, perfect.
Okay, so everyone, so the first party will be the client, right? Who will be your client? So the information of the client goes in these places, okay? And the second party will be the designer, right? So in this information, let's say if you're representing as a legal entity, if you're a private company, if you're LLP, or if you're a partnership firm, right? Then you should be entering details of your partnership firm in here, right? Not your personal details, right? Because if you're entering your personal details, that means you are representing yourself as a proprietor, right? And doing the work in personal capacity. If you do not have anything registered, then only you should be entering your name and details, right? And start a business relationship as a proprietorship. Then the second part is the recital, right? Okay, so it is about what this agreement is all about, like what will be details, right? So you'll be mentioning about the clients, what kind of businesses the client conducts, right? So that to give a brief overview about what the client is into. And then you mention the agreement, like how do you come to meet the client and what kind of work he has been asking you to do it, right? Then you enter these information into place, which I've marked already commented, right? So I think you just go through the comments to get an idea, right? Because I knew that session would not be sufficient to, you know, cover each and everything, so I've already commented each and everything, right, in advance. Definition. Then what I'll be doing is I'll be taking up clauses which goes into agreement and how to negotiate with the client, right? Because what happens that if a client gives you an agreement, right, then it's pretty much obvious that the leverage of that agreement will be tilted on his side, right? And he'll be having the upper hand on the agreement, right? So what you can do is you can negotiate with the client regarding a particular clauses. Okay, so what are the key clauses which you should be keeping in mind while negotiating this particular agreement, right? So I think definition is pretty generic, and so you just need to just see the comments and enter the particular information. There's nothing like very important in there. It's just to give you an idea what the agreement is all about. Then comes the work, right? The first clause, which is very important for you to know in the agreement, is like what kind of services you will be providing, right? Okay, so what the client's lawyer will be doing, it they will be try to keep the work pretty broad in nature, right? So that each and everything can be covered, right? Okay, so let's say for example I just want a designer to design a logo for me, okay? So but just to get more details, just to get more out of that particular relationship, I'll be mentioning just get the branding material. I'll mention branding material as a nature of services I need from a designer, right? So branding material is a pretty huge term, right? Which you shouldn't be entering, right? So you should be, as a designer, what you should be doing is you should be asking specifically to the client, right? So just give me something which has been very narrowed down, what the actual service or what the actual work you need for myself, right? So don't let a client enter a pretty broad term, like broad criteria for the work, right? So which will help, right? Otherwise, he may be asking, like, okay, so you have designed the logo, right? You should be also designing the letter for me, or letterhead for me, these kind of. So these kind of little details that goes into the agreement, which if the designer is not aware about, he might get into a bad relationship with the client in the first place. Okay, then also I've highlighted the yellow part, right? Which you should be reading it, right? And just check if this similar kind of thing is exists in the other agreement which has been presented to you, right? So if this something is present in similar nature, I think you should be discussing this thing with your client, right? As a person, right? Because otherwise your rights won't be protected by the agreement. And what happens, you have agreed on the agreement, it is considered as a law, a legal binding relationship between you and your client, and the agreement is furnished in the court if it goes into disputes and you cannot contend it back, right? So just try to make an agreement which is suitable to both the parties, not vice versa, right? Okay, and also just to boil down, right? So what you can do is you can have an annexure, right? Which I have mentioned that annexure A. So annexure A is a scoped, is a detailed scope project, right? So what are the things that you will be doing it for the company, or what are the things you will be doing it for client, right? So it should be pretty much in a tabular content, right? These are the materials that you will be providing, or these are the content that you will be providing, or whatever whatever the work you have finished, it has to be detailed, and it has to be very narrowly detailed, not a broader description, right? So just try to detail it down as much as possible, provide as many as details in the agreement, because it will be helping you in the end, right? So if your client gives you a broad detail, I think it may happen that you will be asked to change the work again and again, and you will be like thinking about why did I get into this kind of work relationship. So in terms of term, right? So there's something called date of execution, right? So date of execution is when you will be signing the agreement. It has to pretty much necessarily mention in the date of execution, right? Okay, so if you're mentioning date of execution in the agreement, that means it may happen that you have been working with a client, and client may ask you to provide designs which you have worked, right? So mention when you started to work with the clients, and it has to be mentioned the date of execution. So you enter date of execution here only. Okay, and then comes the consideration part, like what kind of, if you're working for a client, what are you working, like what are the consideration you're working. Consideration means any fees or any advantage of which you are taking for the client and then providing the services, right? So there are three formats available, right, which I've included. So just remove the format which aren't working for you, or just keep the format which you think you will be working with your client, right? So it is per hour basis, it can be per design basis, or it can be flat fees for the whole work, right? So just take these things in mind while designing, right? And keep one thing, right?
Okay, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, then
this format would help all of us in this way. Yeah
so this is a pretty detailed format, right? Because yes. The thing is, I've designed it for a company, right? Okay. So yeah. Though it's not a designer friendly, like obviously it will happen in the practice of business also, right? Even you have to agree with the client, right? Because right. Client is always right. Okay, so you cannot have equal rights, but try to negotiate on a equal ground, that this will be fair, this won't be fair, right? I think a client will understand what are the clauses which are directly affecting your work relationship, right? So you can get them removed,
absolutely.
Right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, and so even like a client can say that what are the expenses of your services, like incidental expenses such as postages, courier services, or any other services, or even the softwares which you will be using to using to furnish the design, or using to furnish the services, right? That will be hired by you, and that will be, the fees will be paid by you, not the designer. So these kind of clauses that goes into in the draft, right, which has to be taken care of, right? If you think that you are expecting something from the client, then that has to be particularly mentioned in the agreement first, at the first place. Because once you have signed the agreement, then it is obvious that the client will be expecting each and everything from you, right? Not vice versa.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, and also, like if there any royalty attached once you have finished the work, right? So you have to just mention each and everything in the agreement itself, right? And discuss with the client, right? So if you're not paying a fees, so why a designer get royalties? Because client thinks the kind of fees they will be paying to designer is pretty low. So the designer can make the amount fees through the royalties for a particular amount of time. So there are royalties attached to your particular work, then you should be mentioning in this particular agreement itself.
Okay. Perfect. So meanwhile, Shubham, maybe we can check once if you have any other questions with anyone in the group.
Sure.
Yeah, so we just have 10-15 minutes left for today's
call. Okay. So let's start with the...
Yeah, please continue, Shubham. So, and meanwhile, if anyone has any question, please pitch in.
Um, I think they are no question. Everyone agrees, right?
Yes.
So should I be continuing with the agreement, yeah, or you want to
continue with the slides, maybe whichever slide you think.
Because I think, right, because there's so many there's so much information in, and this is the problem with the legal industry, right? So as a lawyer, we think that everything is a problem, right?
Yes. Okay,
so if I do not communicate this thing to the person, right, I think he might be not be able to do it in the right way. So it's a legal thing, it's a lawyer thing, right? That's right. Why I've been getting into detail so much. So let me just go.
Absolutely. Slides. And Shubham, just a small request, maybe if you can share something from the slides, the main content, if you can share with us, it would be.
So yes, I'll be sharing, like once I'm done with the presentation, at the end I'll be sharing this particular PDF with you guys, right?
Okay, because, perfect. Then it's perfect.
I have asked my designer to specially made it for you guys only. Right. So that's great. Not an issue, right?
Thank you so much for
that.
Yeah. Perfect.
So the other agenda of the session was that how to navigate the disputes that arises between you, right? Between you and the client, and how to, you know, just leave the relationship hazard.
Okay. Shubham, okay. Sorry to interrupt once again. I got one more question in the chat box from Paul. Mm-hmm. Paul, maybe you can ask it to Shubham. You can just be on audio and ask it to him also.
First of all, thank you, Paul, for being here. So I attended your last session, right? It was very informative, right? And as a designer, I think, right, it's a, like, the session was pretty fantastic. And to have you as an expert board, it's pretty fantastic to be there. Thank you so much.
He has some issue with the audio, I think. So his question goes out to you as any idea or info about provisional patents in India?
Okay, yeah, so there are two kind of patents, patent is one, right? But there are two kind of processes that involves the patent, right? The first one is the provisional and the second one is the complete, right? So when you should be filing the provisional patent and when you should be filing a complete patent application, right? So that happens. So let's say if you have an idea, right, and you think that this idea, like, you won't be able to execute an idea, right? And anyone, any other person will be able to file, like, will be filing the patent first, but not you, right? So the provisional patent is to secure your idea initially, right? So let's say if you're an idea, right, idea about a particular, let's say if you're idea about a particular bottle design, okay? So you want that particular idea to exercise, because the prototyping and everything that goes into and you just need to practice it. So what you do, you file a provisional patent, a provisional application to the patent office, right? So once you have filed the provisional patent, you get 12 months of time to file a particular complete application, right? In that 1 year of time, what you can do is you can try the idea, you can just make prototypes out of it, you can just test the idea in the particular market, and everything has been done to secure you, right? Once the period of 12 months is over, what you have to do, you have to file a complete specification about that particular patent in a complete patent application, right? So this safeguards the idea to get this safeguards the idea that how to just move ahead, right? So I'll request, like, if everyone, like, even Paul is going for a patent or industrial design, right? So what I want Paul to start with the provisional patent first, right? Because sometimes what happens is that you think the idea is very pretty good and it will be adopted by each and everyone, right? So once you file the provisional patent application, right, you can just test the idea, you can build prototypes, you can test in the market and everything. If you think that, okay, this will be working and this is worth getting the IPR into, right, then you can just hire a lawyer. Hire a particular lawyer and then get the complete specification about the product in a complete patent application, right? So the provisional patent is to secure a particular idea without getting much into specification. I think that answers the questions, right? Is there anything which I can add, Paul?
Let's see if he writes anything in the chat. Yeah, great, okay. Sorry, some problem here. Don't mind. Thank you, Shubham. Yeah, thanks, Shubham, for that. Yeah. I think his audio is just not working. And
okay.
Tapping in the chat.
No problem, right? I was a bit about the...
Cool.
in compared to other countries, right? Okay, so what happens? So I think Paul is in a dilemma. Like, let's say he comes up with a design, a design product, right? And what is the process in India, and what are the processes in world, right? So what happens is that let's say if you come up with an idea and you file a provisional patent, right? So once you have filed the provisional patent, so the patent is considered from the provisional time period, right? So once you have filed the provisional application, the patent, that journey of the patent starts with the provisional application, right? So as I told you, that the 20 years of time period you get to exercise over a patent, right? So what happens? So the journey of 20 years starts with the provisional patent itself, right? And once you have filed the complete patent, so the time period of 20 years is considered for the provisional patent, right? And also what happens, once you file the provisional patent, then you have a period of 12, as I told you, a period of 12 months to file the similar patent in other countries also. So that your particular idea is secured with, right? Because even India is a signatory to a particular treaty which says that, let's say someone has get the right of first approval of the patent, right? So if you come up with the idea and you file a provisional patent, if you go to other country and file a similar patent application, right? So that country will be considering your first filing as the patent date, not the consecutive filing which has been filed in the particular country. I think that's that summarizes your solution which you wanted to ask, right? So if you have filed in India, it will be considered filing everywhere, but however you have to file the particular patent in that particular country also.
Hi Shubham.
Great.
Yeah, hi.
Hi, this is Santosh here. Yes, I have Santosh. A question regarding if we register as a solo proprietary, is it easy to convert into private limited later?
To be honest, like, sole proprietorship is not a particular legal entity. Yeah, obviously, if there's nothing registered, then you are automatically sole proprietorship, right? But just to start with a company, so you don't need a conversion. You just need to register yourself, right? You need to register yourself as a private company, right? So if you're practicing as a sole proprietorship, then a normal private company registration is pretty much fine, right? But if you're an LLP and if you are if you're a partnership firm, right, then the conversion happens, right? But not the vice versa, right? So sole proprietor is that you are practicing as an individual person, not as any entity, right? So yeah. If you want to register yourself as a company, right, then you can directly go and register as a company, right? And the sole proprietorship will not be getting affected, right?
So while registering private limited, is it if we are doing multiple businesses, is it good to go with private limited? Because the name says that it will be a one business. So
No, so it doesn't happen, right? So everything if you're aware of the process, right? Once you file for a company, right? So there's something called MOU, right? And everything. So you have to mention each and everything. What are the business you will be conducting as a company, right? So if you want to practice so many business areas through a particular one company, right? So you can mention these are the businesses which I'll be practicing through this company, right? And you can mention the documents, right? And then you're free to practice those kind of businesses.
So you mean that in our private limited, we can do multiple businesses?
It is possible, right? So you can conduct so many businesses through a particular one private company.
Okay. Yeah, Shubham. Thank you so much.
Okay, not a issue. Any other questions? Yeah.
That document you said, it's very helpful. Actually, thanks for sharing. Mm-hmm. On the safest ground from the designer perspective, like as you mentioned, some kind of broad language or broad description they're using for that in the documents. So any kind of resource or any kind of link you have where we can check these things or what kind of terminology or what kind of word they're using for that particular designer will be affected. I mean, I clearly said from my safest ground actually. So
yeah, I understand, right?
So many language or so many terminology we don't understand, even we don't go through it because we don't know that as a designer, you know, brand means we have to design something, logo or something. But as you say, it's a broader thing. So any kind of link or anything, resource we can search or we can find to get that kind of terminology or we can.
So Biswajit, like I think this is the. So my startup is based on this problem only, right? Because we know that there's so many things, right? So as I discussed earlier also, right? So even like every legal industry, like so every legal field, they are comprised of two. The one field is something the laws are applicable to. The other thing is the legal industry, right? So people, those who come from different industry, might not be able to learn the legal understanding about the how their particular industry or practice are function, right? So this is a major problem that we are as a startup is actually trying to solve, right? So we use artificial intelligence and human-centered design so that everyone can start using it, right? So so what our startup is all about? So our startup is all about to humanize the language of law for a simple person to understand, right? So what happens, let's say, if you put the agreement which I have shared with you, right? So if you upload the agreement on the product, which we haven't launched so far, but in future, if we launch the so far, so what we'll be giving you insight out of those agreement, right? Which you need to take care of, right? So once you have know the insight, right? You can take a particular measures out of like, what are the things which you need to keep in mind? And we will be drafting a particular agreement as per your requirements, right? So you don't need to deal with the legal part also, and you can get a particular a template or particular agreement done through a non-legal language also. Okay. So this is what we are doing. But as of now, let's say if you want, like our product is not in the market, and if you want to know more about, right, then there are blogs related to IPR. Let's say if you want to know about the IPR, then there is a website called Banana IP, right, which try to explain the IP in simple language, right? But still, those websites are pretty much legal, full of legal jargons, and you won't be able to, right? Because as a designer, as a professional, you want to spend more time practicing design, not on the drafting legal agreements and right for it. Because this is what I suggest. Because it took me 5 years in the college to graduate as a lawyer, right? And after 5 years, still I think that I know so little about the legal field, right? And so it is an ever emerging field, right? And you might not be able to understand each and everything, right? Because even as a lawyer, I do not know each and everything, right? So for everything, I have to look into a details, right? So just to generate those kind of practices, I think it won't be you won't feel ever confident about the kind of material that is being provided by the online platforms, right? So that's why as a startup we are trying to do that. Okay, but you can just go through the blogs, you can go through write about it, but just to rely on that particular blog, it is your personal decision, right? It can, like, I cannot advise you to follow those particular decisions, but it's good to have, let's say, if you're starting a legal, let's say if you're practicing as a designer, right, and you want a particular template as per your requirement, the kind of services you provide, right? So what you can do is you can approach a particular lawyer, right, and just take consultancy take consulting from the particular lawyer regarding your specifically businesses, right? So the positive part of this particular practice is that because in case of dispute happens on that particular particular agreement or particular right for it, you are secured in a particular way because your lawyer or your hired lawyer has already taken your business aspect in picture and provided his consultancy as per your business requirement, right? So also what I have seen that what people do is people go to ready to build format law websites, like those you have to just enter the information into a particular website and the agreement is automatically generated, right? But I'll try to communicate that I think these practices are not very good for a particular industry, right? Because these agreements are very very generic in nature, right? And it doesn't cover your business practices entirely, right? So, and also it may happen that that particular website comes from different jurisdiction, right? It might not be an Indian website. If it comes from a different jurisdiction, it comes from, let's say, it's a US website, right? And then they have molded those agreements according to the laws of the US, right? Not for India, right? So just just take a note, don't use these kind of website, right? Because they are not designed specifically for you, right? So hire a lawyer. It will save you a lot of cash in future and a lot of trouble in future, right? And specifically, you do not need to hire a big shot law firm or whatever. Even there are consultants who are easily available, right? Which you can do, right? Okay.
Thank you. Thanks.
I would like to add something. So all of you guys, you can find a lot of IP law related groups on Facebook. I have myself joined a lot of IP and law related groups on Facebook, and they keep posting things about different kind of disputes, different kind of challenges and problems. And even if you have not come across those challenges, but you keep aware with all those things over a period of time, would give you a good context that how these things work and what are the common challenge being faced in India especially. So these groups, you can search in Facebook and join it. Very helpful over a period of time. It strengthen you a lot.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Thanks.
Any other question?
Great. Yeah. Any other questions? Because we have already run out of time.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, Shubham, you can share your detail at the end so that people, if they want to reach out to you separately afterwards, they can do that.
Yeah, I already got the number.
Okay. Yeah. So I've already sent the number, right? So yeah. If any problem, right, I'm open to consultancy in person. If the problem is pretty big, I don't charge, right, because I think the relationship is more important, right, to navigate, right. And as a person, right, who cares so much about human being, as a designer, I think there are a lot of people who get into legal trouble and they don't have easily financial cash available with them just to pay for the consultancy and everything, right? So I just try to provide consultancy in a normal rates, right? And also in free some cases if they are students, if they are not able to have financial backgrounds, right? Check, right? Or it can be more of a barter system. Let's say if they are a young designer, right? Those who want to also work and also they want a legal help, right? So I just try to allocate work and provide consultancy. This is how I work, right? Yeah. Because I know everyone is not able to afford the legal needs, right? And this is what we are trying to do as a startup, just to try to give effectively the legal services at the minimal cost, right, which is applicable in India.
Yeah. Shubham, colleges you told in Karnataka and in Gujarat having mm-hmm. diploma courses. If you can share those name of the colleges and the diploma courses, if that is possible.
Sure. So I can tell you like few colleges, those who are working very good certificate courses. So you just check out the website of these colleges, NL.
You are typing, okay.
Yeah, NLSIU, okay. It's in Bangalore, right? Okay, then you can also, there's a one good college in Kolkata also, NUJS.
Okay. I'll just type in the chat.
And then there are professional courses provided by FICCI.
FICCI provided by?
FICCI, FICCI.
Okay.
Okay, and even my college provide good courses related to IPR or related to business practices, right? So which you can just do, get a certification, right? So this, I think this should be helping you people to get an idea, right? How the law meets the design and what are the things that you need to take care of as a designer, right? And if you want to as a designer, you want to understand more about the legal industry, you are open to work with me also, so I can just share the knowledge of how we're doing. Because for my startup, I'm also working as a designer, a service designer, digital product designer, right? So we're trying to bring down the complex processes in the simplest manner and just try to provide the services, right? So everything is invited to have a discussion over the kind of product that can be built for the legal industry using design methodology.
Absolutely, yeah, perfect.
Yeah, that would be really helpful. Yes,
Great, yeah. So it would be really great, Shubham, if you can share the document with me afterwards so that I can share it with all the participants today.
So, document. So let me share it now only.
Great, yeah, that's perfect, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I think the whole meetup went very fruitful from the point of view that we get to know about a lot of things. We also get to know how to venture into these kind of things as a designer, where we can put our foot and still keep the balance. I hope the participants who have attended, most of your doubts have been cleared. What is your point of view? Any feedback or anything? Please open up. Say it right away.
Something. Yeah, we would love to hear something from you guys.
Yeah, it's very fruitful, and I it's very much clear, and we are already in the design field, and some terminology you don't know, that is already very fruitful for us. Thank you, Shubham.
Thank you, Vishwajit, for the kind feedback.
So, anyone else? Most of the people have not spoken, so this is the right
moment. At least now we know where to go to in case we have any doubts regarding this topic.
Sure. You are most welcome. So any doubt you have in mind, right? So yeah. I'll also do one thing. I'll share my LinkedIn profile with you guys, right? So
sure.
You can just connect with me over the LinkedIn and shoot a query over the message, and I'll be happy to answer that queries.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Shubham.
Okay. Thank you, Romy and Ratul. Thank you for making it possible, right? I think without you guys, this won't be possible, right? And you have been helpful for these kind of sessions that I pretty much expect that. I think for the design field, these kind of sessions will be very helpful for the designers, right? So the kind of initiatives you guys are taking, right? It's pretty commendable. And this is one of the most important forums, right? Which I actually taking these kind of initiative, right? So just to initiate a particular project, right? It's a pretty big feat for you guys also. Thank you so much.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Shubham, to you too. Law and accounting are very important part of any kind of business. And I would look forward with Romy that we could, present these kind of topics on a bigger platform, through some other engagement and all, with a bigger public. But to start with, this was a really great initiative, a really great program. We get to know a lot of things, and knowledge sharing was really good.
Okay, thank you. So there's a question, like, I think there's a question people are opening up, right? So has there been any laws to promote the ethical design, right? Okay, so I mean, that's a very good question, right? Because there are a lot of news going around in foreign countries, right, regarding the ethical design, right? Dark designs or something, right? How you should be designing, right? Because the thing is that there are not specific set of laws that are applicable to designers, right, for it. But some criminal laws, they directly or incidentally applies to these kind of practices, right? So there are a lot of cases regarding the promoting of ethical design, right? So if you know that designing a particular advertisement, when to show the advertisement, so there's a very good case related to this, right, which has come out of Indian judiciary. So they are not a scripted law from the parliament, but the judiciary has taken cognizance in these kind of offenses and provided cases. But these cases, they just go into the document files and are not being shared by the general public or designers, right? So they might not be aware about it because they didn't come from the parliament, right? But there are cases which are related helpful in ethical designing, right? If something you are facing a problem with from ethical designing, or you think that any company which is practicing unethical designing, you can always coordinate with me, right? So I can take up the matter and take these kind of things actually very seriously, right? Because even normal lawyers don't take these things seriously. They don't think that designing as an industry is pretty important, right? But someone I'm a lawyer, and once I've known that what is the scope of the designing industry is, right, I take these kind of things very seriously and try to do as much as possible from my side.
That's right. It's very important to practice ethical design, and in lack of ethical design, a lot of disaster could happen. That have been happening also. Like if you have heard about the Boeing case where the plane crashed, two of the MAX planes, because of some poorly configured software, which was responsible for balancing the whole plane. Now their production line have stopped, and a lot of things have happened over last 2-3 years. So it's all a part of ethical design, proper testing, proper delivery, and something which is, you know, by everyone for everyone. So yeah, that is an important thing to touch about.
Great. Okay. So yeah, let's wrap up for today then. And I would really like to thank Shubham and Ratul for the session, for hosting and being a part of the panel in the guest, and hosting the session also, Ratul. So thank you everyone for joining in. Let's connect again in some next few weeks. So most probably our next, I can just give an introduction of our next expert speaker. Would be Sudhir Sharma from Indie Design. So I'm in talking terms with him, and most probably in March, we will have him on our call sessions. And for Kolkata, there had been a request for a face-to-face meetup since some time. So as much as feedback I have collected from you guys on the dates and all, so most of the people has voted for 29th of February for a face-to-face meetup, which is next weekend, Saturday. So I will schedule a face-to-face meetup for next Saturday. This was just a heads up for you guys. By tomorrow or day after, you would be getting a request, and please be there. And let's meet and let's take it forward again. So thanks a lot, Shubham, once again for this wonderful session. And thanks for all the information you have shared. It was really great having you on the show then.
Thank you, everyone. Yeah. Goodbye.
Yeah, thank you. Bye, everyone. Yeah. Thank you, Shubham.
Goodbye. Okay, thank you so much. Bye, guys.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Thank you.